Okay.
Okay, let's go to Toronto, where Mark Breslin is standing by. He is the founder and president of Yuck Yucks, the largest comedy chain in North America, perhaps the world. He is also royalty. He has been knighted by the Queen of England. So we're going to talk about the Duke of York, who I understand he vacations with in Tibbies. Is it pronounced Antibes? Where do you go with the Duke?
First of all, it's not the Duke of York. It's the Duke of Earl.
Oh.
1962, Gene Chandler. Interestingly enough, the Duke of Earl in that song is a pimp. And interestingly enough, Prince Andrew is, well, you see where I'm going.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah. So that's who I actually vacation with. And we go to Schenectady and hang out. So, you know, we're not fancy people. We're not fancy royals. And I think that's what's important. We're down to earth royals.
Well, Prince Andrew is I guess he was the Duke of York. I don't want to say his interview with the BBC was a car crash, but at one point he shouted, "Faster, Doty, faster, Doty."
That's funny.
I had that in my pocket.
I don't think they... I knew that. I don't think they strip him of his title.
Oh.
When something like this happens. He has his title, but he becomes, you know, sidelined and irrelevant.
Well, they threw him out of Buckingham Palace last Friday. They literally fired his appointment secretary, shut down his office, and
and this guy's going to have to somehow live on $300 million that's sitting in the bank for him or more. It's pathetic. I feel so much for the guy.
What kind of mother would do that to a son, other than ours?
Yours, mine. I have my friend who's a lawyer sue his family because there was a will and he was cut out of it, and he missed out on millions of dollars and did not win and had to pay court costs and tried to kill himself.
Well,
and I had to go check him in to the hospital, to the psych ward, 2 weeks ago.
Oh, really?
So I guess. Yep.
Oh, wait a second. This is a billion. This is a guy who.
No, this is a guy who's a lawyer, and he's been my lawyer for a long, long time, and a good friend.
I'm sorry. I went through a divorce, and I would give anything for one of my five lawyers to try to kill themselves.
Yeah. I see. No, this guy's kept me alive for a long time,
okay.
Believe me.
All right.
He's my pit bull.
Okay, and is he okay?
Yeah, he's still in the psych ward, and we've... A bunch of his friends, including myself, have got sort of a plan for him when he comes out. But it's not pleasant stuff. It was on the same day that my brother-in-law died.
Oy.
So I had a bad day that day. Yeah, I know. But my brother-in-law was 93. He had Alzheimer's. He didn't recognize his own poo. You know, it's...
I hate that when that happens. When you see your poo and you go, do I know you? Have we met?
Yeah, who is this? Why is he smiling at me? You know? So anyway, I had a bad day. That was a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah. Well, there are bad people on this planet. The Queen is not one of them. I like the Queen. I think America would be better off if we got absorbed into the Commonwealth.
If you want a Queen, you only have to vote for Pete Buttigieg. it'll be covered.
How do you fire?
He's not queenly. He's not like a queenly gay, is he?
No, he's not.
Not like that kind of gay at all.
No.
Not at all. Like, maybe he's I like Stephen Sondheim gay, but definitely not a queenly gay.
Right, where you can see it. I like Stephen Sondheim because that's Jewish gay, where you're not sure if he's a mama's boy or gay, right? That's the great thing about Jewish men. You're never quite sure if they're gay or just good sons.
Well, here's the thing. I'm a big lover of Broadway musicals, and I'm straight. And there's a whole bunch of guys, Jewish guys, and they're always Jewish guys, in my life, friends of mine, acquaintances of mine, who also are Jewish guys who love Broadway plays and go out for coffee and sit and argue vehemently about Sondheim or Lin-Manuel. Like, it's pretty funny, actually. Because when you go to a Broadway show and you see the audience is there and it's half men, half women, I guarantee it's the women who drive the tickets. I guarantee almost no man says, honey, that revival of Oklahoma is supposed to be amazing. But I would, and I have.
Uh-huh. That's the difference between you and me, because I wish, because I live
you're not a musical fan, are you?
I wish I were. I it's like baseball. It's one of those things where,
I like baseball.
I'm sorry?
And I like baseball.
Yeah, it's a character flaw of mine. There are people who, I remember Rosie O'Donnell talked about being a troubled kid, going to a Broadway musical and finding her meaning in life. And I remember going to a musical and thinking, I can't believe they're charging this much for this shit.
Anyway, I'm not sure how we got onto this. But
firing your family.
I do love musicals.
Yeah. Firing your family. Now, Queen Elizabeth fired her son. Our Thanksgiving is approaching. I have a list of family members who I would like to fire before Thanksgiving starts up. You had Thanksgiving before we did. Now, does your Thanksgiving in Canada predate the American Thanksgiving? And what do Canadians have to be thankful for other than not living in America?
Well, that's a rather big thing, thank you. But no, our Thanksgiving could not precede yours because we're a newer country. I'm not sure when, I don't have a scholarly knowledge of when the first Thanksgiving was, legitimately, rather than the story about John Young and Pocahontas.
I don't know that story.
That was supposed to be the first Thanksgiving.
Oh.
Back in 1624, John Young, who's a British colonizer, falls in love with Pocahontas. I mean, I guess he'd really like to poke her hauntus.
Back then, you could go to jail for poking a woman's hauntus.
Yes, you can, especially if she's underage, which she was. She was 12.
Was she really?
She was 12. Yeah, Pocahontas was 12. And
that must have been an amazing hauntus.
They had a dinner, and the dinner gave thanks for the harvest. And that was supposedly the first Thanksgiving. That's the way I understand it. In Canada, there was never anything quite like that. I'm not sure when the tradition starts, but it would have to have been after 1867, which is when Canada became a country. Hmm. And Thanksgiving here doesn't mean quite the same thing as it does there. For instance, you have this magnificent turkey dinner, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we just have a little chicken. That's all. We'll have a little chicken, thank you.
But not turkey?
It doesn't. Now, because everybody wants to, it's competitive Thanksgiving time, a lot of people do have turkey. We don't actually have a turkey in our family. We go out and we buy a pre-made sliced turkey dinner for everybody in a nice box.
I see. And Christmas Day, what is Christmas Day? Is that Chinese restaurants for the Jews?
Used to be, but with all the intermarriage, it's more likely to be sitting around the under the tree swearing that the kids' toys didn't come with batteries. Right? It's I have a tree in my house. Since I got married and I have a child, and I was aghast for the first 3-4 years. I just couldn't believe I would come downstairs and see this big piece of goy just sitting there flashing lights just so in case I might have missed it, since it's huge and it goes up almost 2 stories in my house. Just been appalled. And now I'm kind of okay with it because it's just a nice thing to look at.
Yeah.
And I don't see any religion in it. I just see cash.
Now, your wife is not Jewish.
My wife is a lapsed Catholic.
Okay.
She's a shamed Catholic,
mm-hmm.
Ashamed of what the Catholic Church has done, and rarely invoked anything, any traditions of Catholicism. My son was never baptized, for instance,
mm-hmm.
and my son will probably have a bar mitzvah. So I would say my family is blended but leans towards the Jewish side.
Yeah, yeah. That's what we did. I married a lapsed Catholic. And
well, that's not the words. Wait, those aren't the words you used for her. When you were telling me about that. Yeah. Don't remember that, David.
We're talking about my second wife.
Yes, of course.
Yes, my second wife, not my first.
No.
We must be very careful what we say.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, the one thing that I had a problem, and I grew, was the tree. Like it was hard for me that somehow the tree was surrender. You know, I felt like not having a tree is, I don't know. It's too easy to have a tree. It smells good. It makes you feel happy. I just clenched my, I am not going to succumb to happiness. You won't do this to me. I will be miserable during the holiday seasons.
Well, I wish the tree made all that difference in the world in terms of how you feel on the holiday season. Isn't really much of a mood elevator for me. It's kind of a neutral thing. I'm sort of okay with it. I don't like having to schlep it in with my wife and set it up. That's not really fun. Decorating it is fine, but you know, here's my history. You'll find this interesting. My parents were, seriously Jewish when I was growing up. And when I was in grade 6, I had a girlfriend named Robin Sundstrom. I still remember her name.
What's her last
name? Beautiful Sundstrom.
Sundstrom?
Yeah.
Wow.
She was Swedish.
Hmm.
They were Swedish. And she was a beautiful, sweet little Swedish girl. And one day in late November, I went over to her house after school. And then I came back right for dinner, and I was a bit late. My parents said, "Where were you?" And I said, "Oh, I was over at Robin Sundstrom's house." And they said, "Oh, what were you doing there?" I said, "Well, I was decorating their Christmas tree."
Oh, boy.
And I got a spanking. Seriously, I got a spanking for decorating the Christmas tree and was told, "Don't ever, ever do that again." And then when we got our Christmas tree here, I kind of hoped that maybe after the tree was trimmed, my wife would go upstairs with me and I'd get a spanking. So I now associate a sexual kink with the tree. You know, in my house, when I was growing up, this may be true for you, too. Think about this. If you were a kid and you used the word fuck or shit or piss, they would be pretty unhappy about it, your parents.
Right.
But if you used the word Christ, it was all over. That was the dirty word.
Not for me. My parents.
No,
yeah.
For us, it was the word that starts with C and ends with T. And you know what that is. Christ.
I think we came from different families because both my parents were the children of immigrants through Ellis Island. So there was a lot of shame associated with that. And they wanted me to assimilate.
Well, my parents' parents would have been immigrants.
Yeah, right.
In that way. But my parents were actually born in North America.
Yeah. Well, hang on. Your parents' parents were born in North America.
Yeah.
Right. So, I grew up at a time when, if you spoke Yiddish, it was frowned upon. They were ashamed of it. There's a lot of shame associated with.
Well, especially remember Yiddish was really considered at that time post-war. Post-World War II, Yiddish was considered the language of the concentration camps. And it was at that point that Jews stopped speaking Yiddish as a second language and started speaking Hebrew, because Hebrew was seen as the language of liberation and rubber bullets. So, you know?
Yes. But Yiddish is a beautiful language.
Yiddish is a beautiful language, and there are still courses being taught. You know, here in Toronto at U of T, you can actually get your degree in Yiddish, and some people are trying to keep it alive as much as possible. When I went to the shiva for my brother-in-law, there was a guy there who I kind of know. He's a vague family relation, a cousin, second cousin, eighth cousin, whatever, and he speaks fluent Yiddish and speaks it beautifully. I can only pick up a word here and there.
Well, the great thing about...
We spoke Yiddish in the house, but... I didn't. My parents were able to do that as a second language, not a first.
I'm sorry that I didn't hear Yiddish growing up. I heard Yid growing up.
Yes, I'll bet you did.
But I didn't hear Yiddish.
Well, that was just before the fist made contact with your face, right? And that was in Hebrew school, which made it even weirder.
Right. You know why Jews are so annoying? We want somebody to punch us in our nose so it gets down to a reasonable size.
That's funny.
But the thing about Yiddish to people who don't understand it is the Jews in Eastern Europe moved all around, and they took with Yiddish a little bit of German, a little bit of English, a little bit of Hebrew, a little bit of Hungarian. It's kind of like the Jews picking out fruit at a market. I'll take a little bit of that. I'll take that. That looks good. We'll take this, and we'll take that, and this, this, that, and this. And it's a funny language.
Yes, and that's, unfortunately, that it is a funny language, because when they went to buy that fruit, they bought all the stuff on sale. It was already half rotting. So I've heard, you know, they say it's a low German, but I've heard high German spoken, and it's a beautiful language. When Hitler isn't screaming, German can actually be a very lovely language.
Hmm. My son speaks fluent German.
Really? Why?
All I've ever heard him say is, I wish I wasn't born a Jew, in German. But no, he went to Germany for 2 years.
Really? And,
yeah, after graduation, he decided...
Odd choice.
I'm sorry?
It's an odd choice.
It's when the refugees were being admitted, and it was kind of like Prague after the fall of the wall.
Uh-huh.
That's what the kids were saying, at least.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. What were you going to say? I interrupted you.
I can't remember.
Okay. So billionaires, you said your lawyer is was supposed to be the heir to a billionaire?
No. No, he just had a family. There was a bit of a family fortune, and he was cut out of the will. He sued, and he lost. Mm. But he's nowhere near a billionaire status. That's mere millions. But I personally know three, perhaps four people who are billionaires here in Canada.
Okay. The reason I'm asking is Michael Bloomberg, 77-year-old Michael Bloomberg, former mayor of New York City, worth conservatively... or neoliberally, $50 billion. He announced Sunday that he is seeking the Democratic nomination for president. So you know billionaires. I've never met a billionaire. What do they have?
I'm friends with billionaires. They have things like private planes.
These are Canadian billionaires.
Even Canadian billionaires. They have private planes, and they have houses with ballrooms in them for those classical concerts, I suppose, that they book.
Mm-hmm.
And no worries, which is a really great thing to be a billionaire. They don't really have a lot of worries except their health. So it is definitely a different world than you or I. But the billionaires I know are all nice people, certainly to me. Most of them don't really work. They're managing family trusts and stuff, so... they do a lot of charity work. It's, I don't know.
Is it going to be taxed? Is there a wealth tax in Canada?
Well, there is a very high income tax at the top end. Yeah.
So it's harder to be a billionaire.
I wouldn't quite call it a wealth tax, because it's graduated anyway. So if you're a mere multimillionaire, you're also getting taxed at a much higher. Our tax is about a third to a double what yours are.
So it is much harder to get to a billion in Canada.
I would say so, yeah.
Okay.
But they do exist.
And are they celebrated the way we do here?
Well, very few people. It's not a braggy thing here because, remember, it's Canada. You don't brag about anything. If you got a deal on a donut, you don't even brag about that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just not a braggy thing. But, I have surmised that these friends are at that level of wealth. Nobody showed me their bank book and went, "Hey, look!" So, which they might do in the States,
yes.
You know, but also the billionaire class don't tend to affect politics in the same way that I think they do in the United States. They don't seem as politically involved, and they're not necessarily like some kind of right wing cabal. A lot of them are liberals and that sort of thing.
Right. Is there a healthy mistrust, indeed, antipathy and or hatred for billionaires in Canada?
It's such a non-issue that I can't even comment upon it. They're kind of quiet and hidden. They release on the internet a list every year, you know, the 25 wealthiest families, and they're all worth billions and billions of dollars, and half of them you've never even heard of. So there's not that same kind of public interface with billionaires, or is it sit on my face with billionaires? I know one of the
when we were growing,
sat on the face of a billionaire, but completely different. Their cock rings are gold, solid gold.
When we were growing up, there was shame associated with wealth.
I don't remember that at all. No, I don't remember that at all. I grew up in a kind of an upper middle class, professional class area, and everybody had money, and there was no shame at all. In fact, what there was a lot of pride about it. On the other hand, only in my high school would the welfare council, which arranged charity for poor kids, be the most popular thing to join.
Hmm.
So you could call that guilt, or you could call that, you know, Jews in the 60s.
Right. Who's a bigger threat to the planet, billionaires or the professional class? I think the professional class is more dangerous. I think doctors, lawyers, and their kids and their ambition are more of a threat to the planet than billionaires.
I'll tell you who the most dangerous people are: MBAs. They're the apparatchiks of whatever the billionaires might want, or the millionaires might
yes.
want.
Yes.
I'm always worried about MBA types. It always seems like a kind of policy wonk, amoral kind of group of people, and I know many of them, and that class worries me a lot.
You had taught me about Hannah Arendt and the banality of evil. I remember sitting at, where did we used to stay in Montreal? What was the hotel?
Oh, geez.
It was like, not Delta Dawn or something. Anyway, and you had told me about the Holocaust. They were able to achieve the Holocaust because of the banality of evil. And you turned me on to Hannah Arendt or Arendt. And when I look at MBAs, my son has a friend who went and got an MBA. He's now working for a hedge fund manager. It's the banality of evil. He goes to work, sits there, and presses buttons, has no qualms.
Yeah, exactly. And nobody thinks out what the ultimate effect of that button pushing might
right.
be.
Right.
But to be fair, if you read Hannah Arendt, you can also, it's a bit of a slog, and it's a bit of, the banality of Hannah Arendt is also a bit of a problem. And and I went to that Broadway play, bringing it back to Broadway play, and I was very unsettled that it wasn't really about her. It turned out it was Rent, not Hannah Arendt. I thought they had made a play about it. But I thought Annie was about... look, David, I thought Annie was about Anne Frank. About Anne Frank. I don't know. I thought... I don't remember her having curly red hair. But maybe, yeah, actually, it was kind of curly. And, you know...
Yeah. Daddy Warbucks.
What do I know about these things? You know what? I thought Paps, you know, I know so little about women on every other level. I thought Pap Smear was a character in Little Abner. So, you know, it's I'm sometimes in the dark about so many things.
Pap Smear. Yeah. Was that Al Capp? Who wrote Lil Abner?
Yes, that was Al Capp, who was kind of a right-wing guy back in the 60s.
Yeah, yeah. Had one leg, right?
I didn't know that. I usually collect information on amputees, but I didn't know that he only had one leg. I know Cody Fields did, and that she placed first in the circular swimming competition.
Oh, my God.
And around and around and around she goes.
All right. We have limited time here. Please.
On the planet or on the show?
On the show. Behave.
Oh my God.
Billionaires. Is it considered?
Billionaires.
Let me ask you a hypothetical. Assuming Trump isn't a billionaire and that he views the U.S. government as a giant pile of money waiting to be grifted, and assuming Bloomberg is a billionaire, a patriotic, America-loving billionaire, everything Trump is not, could there be an upside to a President Bloomberg in the White House? Is there anything a billionaire could bring?
Well, you're supposed to believe that at least he's not going to line his own pockets because he doesn't need to, and that's always some kind of a comment. The question, of course, is Trump really rich, or is he just, has he been coasting on fumes for forever? Which I suspect is kind of closer to the truth.
Yeah.
If this were any other election, the fact that Bloomberg were a billionaire would mean less. But now everything's been colored by Trump's fraudulent statements. So I'm not sure that it's a plus or a minus. I think his age plus the billionaire thing might be a minus. I mean, they just keep looking for older people. I hear they're going to like old age homes looking for Democratic candidates now.
That way we know they're full of shit.
Well, yeah. No, not actually, they're not. It's all in the bedpan. and that might be a good slogan for one of them. It's all in the bedpan.
From a chicken in every pot to
it's all in the bedpan.
Has Canada ever had a Jewish or a female prime minister?
Yes, we had a female prime minister very briefly. Her name was Kim Campbell. She was a conservative, but not a right-wing conservative, but her time as prime minister was very short. It was only a couple of months. She was kind of a placeholder, I guess, till they found somebody else. The somebody else they found was way worse, which was Stephen Harper, who governed Canada for many years. I think it was 12 years, and he was kind of right-wing out of Alberta. Interestingly enough, Kim Campbell left when they gave her a posting as ambassador to the U.S. and
went to Harvard.
She
went to Harvard and stayed, right?
I think so, but a more salient detail for what we were talking about is she took up and had a romance and may still have it with Hershey Felder. Who's Hershey Felder?
Raoul Felder's brother?
No. It might be, yes.
Thomas's brother?
Yes, I believe so, but no, it would be his nephew or his probably, because he was not an old guy, but he was a Broadway composer and wrote all kinds of Broadway shows. So there's another straight Jew who likes Broadway.
Hershey Felder.
Hershey Felder.
I know his children, the Hershey squirts, we call them.
Oh.
I didn't know there was a Hershey Felder. I knew Raoul Felder, the famed divorce attorney.
That's right.
Was Doc Pomus.
Did you ever see the documentary on him?
I think so.
It's wonderful.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful doc.
Save the Last wonderful Dance doc. For me.
Right. Because he couldn't really dance because he had a bum leg. So he sat there at his own wedding watching his wife, his new wife, dance with every guy. And he wrote the lyrics to that song while he was watching them dance with her at his own wedding.
It's a beautiful song. And his
Yes, it is a beautiful song.
And it's as beautiful as Raoul Felder is ugly. Now I'm going to get sued by him. Right?
Yeah. Yep, because he'll sue at a drop of a hat.
Yeah, at the drop of a yarmulke.
Yes, the drop of a yarmulke.
Hey, did Kim Campbell, before you go, were there sexy pictures of her? Did she pose for Playboy or something?
No. She was an attractive matron.
There were no photographs of her. Or am I thinking of Jacques Chrétien?
that's going to make me lose my lunch.
Seriously, there was nothing of her?
When you say photograph, you mean sexy photograph?
I can remember, in the late 80s, pictures of her.
No, first of all, I think she would have been prime minister around the year 2000.
Okay. All right.
I don't know who you're thinking of, but it's certainly not Kim Campbell.
Okay. Glenn Campbell.
There were no scandals with her. She wasn't prime minister all that long.
Right.
But she's the only woman prime minister. There have been no Jewish prime ministers.
There have been no Jewish, and could there be a Jewish prime minister?
Yes. There have been Jewish premiers, which is like governors,
mm-hmm.
But there have been no Jewish prime ministers. But there's no reason to think that a Jewish person couldn't lead his party and win.
Okay. And before you go.
Yeah.
Margaret Trudeau.
Love her.
Is she still with us?
Yeah, I just went to see her one-woman show about 2 months ago. She has a one-woman show with slides and everything, and she does it in, mid-sized theaters. I think it was about like a 600-seat theater, and we went to see it. It was sold out for the run about 2 weeks, and she was funny. She was poignant. She was strongly in favor of hippie values and feminist values, sort of early feminist values, a woman can do anything kind of thing, and Helen Reddy stuff. Mm. And it was great. She was terrific. I've always liked her.
She is the mother of your current prime minister. And is she a political net plus for him?
A political... she's not really relevant in any of this. She's kind of considered, she's always been considered kind of a wild child, kind of a flake. If you remember going back to when she was married to Pierre Elliott Trudeau, the prime minister then, she was 30 years younger than him and chafed at the job and was caught cavorting with the Rolling Stones when they were performing in Toronto. She was always shot. They were taking pictures of her at dancing with Jack Nicholson at Studio 54. She was a regular Studio 54 habitué, just a flower child. And
right.
Some people loved her.
And you dated her, didn't you? Didn't you actually go out? I read in the paper that you dated her.
No, I didn't date her. I dated a lookalike and then made people believe I was having a fling with Margaret Trudeau.
Oh, that's right.
I was sitting in a... I think I told this story already. I was sitting in a bar one night, and this woman kind of came along to take my order, and I said, "Oh my God, has anyone ever told you look just like?" She said, "Everybody." I went, and then the wheels started turning, and I thought, "Here's a way to prank the media."
Mm-hmm.
And it all worked out great. And the there was complete buzz in the restaurant when we went there, and everybody believed she was Margaret Trudeau. And I had friends planted at the restaurant calling the media saying, "You'll never believe this, but Mark Breslin is there with them." Right? And all worked great. And when I walked out with her, the flashbulbs were just going crazy. There were cameras, everything. And somebody said, people would say, like, Mr. Breslin, can you comment upon your relationship with Margaret Trudeau? I said, I'm not going to use my personal relationship to further my career in any way. And everything would have been fine, and they would have printed the whole thing, except that night there was a big picture released of her dancing with Jack Nicholson in Studio 54, and they never ran anything, and the press was mad at me, and I didn't have much of a good relationship with the press for about 2 years after that.
All right.
Good prank. It's a really good prank.
Yes. It's time for another one. It's time for another. We got to do something with lookalikes. We got to find some lookalikes.
Yeah, lookalikes are great. I love lookalike. Lookalikes are funny. Always funny.
But not big name lookalikes. You know, something like a Raoul Felder lookalike.
Yeah, Mark Breslin having supper with Jeffrey Tambor.
Exactly.
Ignoring the fact that every Jew that I know of that age is bald and slightly overweight.
And getting sued. Mark Breslin is the founder and president of Yuck Yucks, the largest comedy chain in North America, perhaps the world. And what is, in all seriousness, what do you have on your lapel? Besides spittle,
I have chicken soup that I grilled from last night. I have an Order of Canada, and the Order of Canada is a small pin with a maple leaf on it.
All right, we have to do one with Joel Axler sitting in the background, just screaming at us. That would be funny.
Happiness.
Can you stand on the line for 1 second, sir?
Yeah, because I have to tell you something.
Okay.